Welcome to the sixth lecture of this MOOC, Introduction to Biorisk Management. In this lecture, I will be discussing the World Health Organization Laboratory Biosafety Manual and the Pathogen Safety Data Sheets. These are essential guidelines in order to assess the risk posed by known biological agents. Please note that all risk assessment must be done using known biological agents as a reference. We cannot conduct a risk assessment for unknown biological agents. Welcome back to this lecture on risk assessment. In today's lecture, I will discuss the pathogen safety data sheet as well as specific guidelines in the World Health Organization Laboratory Biosafety Manual pertaining to risk assessment. The learning objectives for this lecture are as follows. I will introduce you to the process of risk assessment for a known biological agent. Please take note that risk assessment can only be conducted for known biological agents. We cannot conduct a risk assessment for unknown biological agents as the risk is not perceptible or the risk is unknown. We will discuss the key points that must be addressed during risk assessment pertaining to the characteristics of the pathogen, and we will also discuss the pathogen safety data sheets, which is a very important document that is utilized currently by biorisk managers across the world, and we have to be thankful to the Government of Canada for developing this excellent resource. The learning outcomes for this module are as follows. Upon completion of this module, I want you to demonstrate the ability to develop a questionnaire or an instrument for risk assessment, address specific criteria pertaining to risk assessment based on your own localized situation, and apply the information from the PSDS to assess the risk posed by a known biological agent. Risk assessment functions within a scope. There are risks that are within the scope of an assessment and risks that are beyond the scope of an assessment. This is the iceberg analogy, in which this is the risk that you see and which you perceive, and this is the risk which you do not see and cannot perceive. The World Health Organization Laboratory Biosafety Manual contains specific guidelines for microbiological risk assessment. These focus on specific criteria or characteristics of the microbe, such as the pathogenicity of the microbe, the potential outcome of exposure in terms of morbidity and mortality, the natural route of infection, other routes of infection, stability of the biological agent in the environment, concentration and culture volume of the biological agent with respect to the specific laboratory procedure or laboratory operation, as well the presence of a suitable host or vector for transmission of the biological agent, the a priori information available from researchers and other studies pertaining to that particular biological agent, specific laboratory procedures which increase the risk of exposure, such as pipetting, centrifugation, and extraction of nucleic acids, any genetic manipulation of the organism in case of a genetically modified organism which has been incorporated or endowed with specific traits such as the increase in host range or the transmission, local availability of effective prophylaxis or therapeutic interventions with respect to that particular biological agent. Please take note that each biological risk assessment must be conducted for a specific biological agent. For instance, if you have developed a risk assessment for Mycobacterium tuberculosis, the same risk assessment cannot be utilized for Pseudomonas aeruginosa or a coronavirus. The risk assessment must also take into account the current availability of facilities as well as the training elements. This is a specific questionnaire or an instrument for risk assessment. Now, the questions have to be very specific and the answer will be either yes or no. This is an example which you can adapt to your own respective facilities. The first question is, has the biological agent been reported to be a pathogen? In this case, prior information is required, a prior report. The next question focuses on morbidity. Does exposure to the biological agent lead to morbidity? So you have yes or no, as the case may be. The route of infection, is it via inhalation? So this may then lead to your risk mitigation strategy, which involves the usage of respiratory protection for inhalation, such as masks. Route of infection via contact, yes or no. Stability in the environment, is the biological agent viable outside of the host, or does it basically get degraded in the environment, as in the case of most viruses? Genetic modifications, which may have been carried out by the researchers, and the availability of treatment. These are the basic questions which you must address as a biorisk manager. We then move on to some of the questions which you must pose to your laboratory workers or your principal investigators. The first question pertains to training. Has adequate training been provided to the laboratory workers? If not, additional training must be provided. So it's either yes or no. Contingency plans. These must be put into place in the event of a spill or in the event of a breach of containment. The SOPs must be developed. And if there's a yes, you click on yes. If there's a no, you just select no. Facility. And the facility pertains to the essential equipment, which is based on the risk group. One of the essential equipments which I have discussed earlier is the biological safety cabinet. The availability of the personal protective equipment. The availability of the waste disposal system to prevent release of the biological agent into the environment or a breach of the secondary containment. The security of the facility, as well as specific SOPs related to managing the pathogen. As you can see, most of these questions pertain to processes within the facility itself and the specific controls. And one must conduct this kind of a risk assessment prior to moving on to risk mitigation. We now move on to the pathogen safety data sheets. I will be discussing the template itself and the various criteria which are described in the templates. This is the pathogen safety data sheet website. It is a current document which is updated as information becomes available. And as I mentioned earlier, I would like to thank the Government of Canada for developing this excellent resource material, which is a lifesaver for many biorisk managers. This is the Android version, which is available in the form of an app. You can also find it for other mobile phones, such as the Apple. There are 9 sections which are described in the template, and if you key in the biological agent into the search engine on this particular pathogen safety data sheet website, it will then direct you to these sections. And the section describes the infectious agent as well as the characteristics of the infectious agent. I will go through the sections one at a time, and this will clarify any questions pertaining to the sections and their respective content. So section 1 focuses on the infectious agent, the scientific name, the agent type, whether it's a virus, bacterium, fungus, or prion is indicated. The taxonomy is indicated in terms of its nomenclature and classification. The synonyms, common names, the characteristics of the biological agent in terms of its culture characteristics as well as requirement for a specific medium. The brief description of the biological agent itself and its life cycle. The properties of the infectious agent, which relate to its properties outside of the host. Section 2 focuses on hazard identification. In this section, the pathogenicity and toxicity are addressed. Communicability, the ability of the biological agent to be transmitted across the community. The epidemiology, the host range, the infectious dose and the incubation period. The incubation period is the duration between the exposure to the biological agent and the manifestation of the symptoms. Section 3 focuses on dissemination. It indicates if a reservoir exists. The zoonosis and reverse zoonosis is the biological agent transmitted via an animal and specific vectors. So the reservoir for the biological agent may be a human host, or it may also be an animal host or an insect. Section 4 focuses on the stability and viability of the biological agent. As you must be well aware by now, there are multiple cases of drug resistance or antibiotic resistance in microbes, and these have been reported across the world, and this must be addressed in terms of risk assessment for stability and viability. The susceptibility to disinfectants is another issue which must be addressed, as disinfectants are constantly used in the laboratory in routine cleanup. The conditions for physical inactivation, which may include heat and the application of steam or ultraviolet radiation, as well as the ability of the microorganism to survive outside of the host. All of these pertain to the stability and viability of the microorganism or biological agent. Section 5 must address the available first aid and medical measures, which include surveillance of the laboratory personnel. This may be in the terms of a baseline serum study, first aid and treatment in the event of a breach of containment, vaccination if it exists, and prophylaxis or preventive treatment for the laboratory workers. Section 6 focuses on laboratory hazards. Laboratory hazards are the result of working with the biological agent, and these are likely to be LAIs, or laboratory acquired infection, or hospital acquired infections, as the case may be. The sources and specimen, for instance, if a laboratory worker is working with a tissue sample or a body fluid derived from a patient with a known biological agent, the body fluid may also contain unknown biological agents, which pose a risk to the laboratory worker. There are primary hazards associated with the biological agent itself, as well as specific hazards which are associated with operations involving the biological agent. Section 7 focuses on exposure control and personal protection. In this case, we must identify the risk group 1 to 4, the level of containment which is currently available or which is required, the PPEs or protective clothing, and other protection which may be required in the case of a biological agent. Section 8 focuses on handling and storage of the pathogen, and this encompasses spills in the laboratory, which may pose a risk to laboratory personnel. Appropriate SOPs must be available to address spills. Disposal of the biological agent after completion of the laboratory processes, and storage of the biological agent in the laboratory under the ambient conditions or the ideal conditions for storage of that particular biological agent. Section 9 focuses on regulatory and other information. This may pertain to your specific national or local regulatory information, which may be incorporated into your own specific PHDS. You must also indicate the update in the event that you do apply this template within your local conditions, the name of the content creator, as well as current references for the development of the PHDS. What I have gone through is a template layout for the PHDS, and if you go through the website, you will find that almost all of the biological agents have been clearly organized, and each of their characteristics has been delineated in the sections. That brings us to the conclusion of this lecture on risk assessment. In this lecture, we have focused on microbiological risk assessment based on the WHO LBM. We have understood the scope of risk assessment. We now know that risk assessment pertains to only known biological agents. Unknown biological agents cannot be subjected to a risk assessment. We have looked at the pathogen safety data sheets, and all of this should lead you to the development of your own specific risk assessment. As an exercise for your benefit, I want you to look at your own specific circumstances in your laboratory or your workplace and develop a questionnaire for risk assessment. Assess the risk of exposure of the laboratory personnel to the biological agent which you are currently working with as an exercise. Thank you very much for participating in this lecture, and I wish you a pleasant learning experience. Looking forward to seeing you in the subsequent lectures. Thank you.